would also result in termination of the usufruct. Meaning to say, if there is merger of both the usufruct and the ownership of the same property in the same person, then the usufruct is necessarily terminated. Total loss of the thing, that also results in the termination of the usufruct. Termination of the right of the person constituting the usufruct, that also terminates the usufruct. If I gave you a usufruct over a parcel of land, and during the existence of the usufruct, my rights are declared by final judgment of a court to be null and void, I'm not really the owner, then that's an example of a situation where the usufruct would be terminated by the termination of the rights of the person constituting the usufruct. Renunciation on the part of the usufructuary, that would also terminate the usufruct. Does a renunciation require the consent of the naked owner? The better view is that it does not. It does not. If the loss is not total but partial, of course, needless to state, sabi nga, the usufruct continues on the part of the thing which has not been lost. In the case of multiple usufructs, it is only upon the death of the last usufructuary that the usufruct is terminated. Supposing that the usufruct is granted for the number of years that would elapse before a person would reach a certain age. Let's say I gave you a usufruct today until X reaches the age of 40. And X is, let's say, only 30 years old today. So the usufruct is supposed to last for how long? The duration? 10 years. Okay? Until he reaches the age of 40, he's only 30. Supposing X dies after 5 years, will the usufruct terminate? The answer is no. It continues until the year when he is supposed to reach 40, after 10 years. Unless, of course, the usufruct was granted only in consideration of the existence of X, in which case it would terminate upon the death of X. You take note of the provisions of Article 607. Two situations contemplated here. First situation, usufruct is constituted on both the land and the building. The building is destroyed. What's the consequence? The usufruct over the land continues. Usufructuary has the right to continue using the land, and he has the right to make use of the materials. If the naked owner wants to rebuild, his decision is subject to the concurrence, is subject to the consent of the usufructuary, because his usufruct is over both land and the building. If the usufruct is constituted on the building only, not expressly covering the land, and the building is destroyed, of course, the usufruct on the building ends, but the usufructuary can still make use of the materials. The usufructuary in that situation is also entitled to the continuous use of the land. Because although the land was not expressly included in the usufruct was given only over the building. Of course, a building cannot be floating on thin air. So when he was granted usufruct of the land, necessarily, kasama din yun na yung pinagkakatayuan nun. It necessarily included his right to make use of the land on which the building stands. If the naked owner rebuilds, he has the obligation to pay the usufructuary interest not only on the value of the materials but also on the value of the land. Bakit may interest pati sa value of the land? Because, sabi nga natin, even if the usufruct expressly covered only the building, it necessarily included the use of the land because a building cannot float. Okay. If the property under usufruct has been expropriated, what will be the legal consequence? The naked owner has the obligation to either replace it, okay, with another property of the same kind and value, or depending upon the naked owner, he can simply pay the usufructuary interest on the indemnity paid to him. This was precisely the rule applied by the Supreme Court in the case of Loxin versus Valenzuela, where the property under usufruct was taken under PD 27, yung given to the tenant. Okay? Let's now go to easements. A few important points to remember. Again, try to take note of some of the distinctions between easement and lease. One distinction na naman yung easement is always a real right. Lease is a real right only when more than 1 year registered. Another important distinction, of course, is that an easement, you can only have an easement with respect to immovable property, real property. Yung lease, pwede kahit na personal or movable property. Remember the various types, classifications of easements. An easement may be continuous or discontinuous, apparent or non-apparent, it may be positive or negative. When is an easement considered continuous? An easement is considered continuous if its use does not depend upon the acts of man. It is discontinuous if its use depends upon the acts of man. If it's only used at intervals and depends upon the acts of man. When is an easement apparent? If there is an external sign which continually keeps it in view and reveals its use and enjoyment. It is non-apparent if there is no visible indication of its existence. When is an easement positive? When is it negative? An easement is positive when it imposes upon the owner of the servient estate the obligation of allowing something to be done or of doing it himself. It is negative if it prohibits and prevents the owner of the servant estate from doing something which otherwise he could lawfully do were it not for the existence of the easement. Continuous easement. An easement of drainage. An easement of abutment of a dam. An easement of light and view. These are continuous easements. The easement of light and view continues to be in use even if there is nobody making use of the light and view. It's there. So it's continuous. This continuous easement, right of way. Because it's impossible for a man to be continuously walking to and fro through the right of way, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Its use depends upon human intervention, upon the right of man. What about an apparent easement? If the right-of-way is a permanent right-of-way, there is a permanent road there, that's apparent. Okay? Again, abutment of a dam. Kitang-kita mo, ganyan yan. An easement of aqueduct by express legal provision is always considered continuous and apparent. Therefore, it can be acquired by prescription. Non-apparent easement, the easement of altius non tollendi, the easement, altius non tollendi, if there is such an easement, you are not supposed to build beyond a certain height. Okay? If you are the servant owner, there is, and there are people passing by your property, there is nothing which will indicate that the reason why you are not building beyond the certain height is because there is an easement. So it is non-apparent. Positive easement. Sabi natin, the easement is positive if it imposes upon the owner of the servant estate the obligation of allowing something to be done or of doing it himself. A very good example would be an opening made on a party wall, an easement of light and view through a party wall. That's a positive easement. Because it imposes upon the owner of the servant estate the obligation of allowing something to be done on the servant estate itself. Negative easement. The easement of light and view is negative if you make the opening on your own wall. So there's a wall facing, your wall facing the property of another, you make an opening. That, as long as you comply with the requirements, your notarial prohibition, that will be a negative easement. Why? Because the adjacent owner, the owner of the servant estate, will be prohibited from doing something which lawfully he could do were it not for the existence of the easement. Ano yun? To block your light and view. Okay?